How are you doing, sweetie?
You're a surprise on the fly. Okay.
Well, she's doing fine. She's chewing on everything she can get, you know. She got a chair, on the chair. She tries to eat me. Oh, yeah. She loves it.
Oh, licked it off.
I did Tabasco sauce. She loves it. She's cool.
Don't do what I did. I fell and broke both my arms. At the same time.
I got my nurse's training.
Yeah, I bet you did.
He wasn't happy about that.
Oh my goodness.
Yeah.
see you.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you all for being out here tonight for the first debate for our coroner. And we have Laura McDonald and Stan Rutledge here tonight campaigning for that position. And we also have moderating tonight, B.J. Van Gundy. And B.J. is the former chair of the Gwinnett Republican Party. He is former district chair and former vice chair of the state Georgia Republican Party, and is also a current delegate to the National Convention. So he holds many titles, and we appreciate him coming out this evening to debate or to moderate our debate. Before we get started, I'd like for everyone to stand and let's do the Pledge of Allegiance. Chance to ask a 30-second question, and the opponent will have a chance to answer that question in 2 minutes. So we appreciate everyone being here tonight, and I'll turn it over to our moderator to get started.
Thank you. I don't know how close I have to be to this thing. Hold on. Okay. Is that working? No, it's working. I really don't like having to do this. Test, 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 test.
All right.
I know, we should have done this sound test at about noon today or something, I expect y'all think, right? Should have. Test, test, test. Much better. All right. All right, as you said, I was the vice chairman of the State Republican Party. I got to do a lot of these debates in the past, so for some reason, Carolyn thought I should come up here and do this. I live down in Gwinnett County, down in Peachtree Corners, and I'm honored. I appreciate y'all coming out, and want to say a lot of respect to all y'all for coming out to this kind of thing to learn more about the race and go back and make your neighbors smart about what you think when you leave here tonight. Gentlemen, and let me let you all know, we did a little real high-tech, how many fingers am I holding up behind my back to figure out who gets to go first tonight. And Lauren, if you don't mind, we're going to go on first-name basis. Lauren chose to defer to the second half, so Stan will answer the first question first, and then Lauren. And I guess the most important question that everybody always wants to know is, why are you running for the office of coroner? Stan?
Can you hear me? Is it on now? Okay, with my experience, the way my heart leads me, I've been a deputy coroner for 3.5 years. My whole thing has been in public safety. My opening statement is that I want to thank the Republican Party for hosting this debate. I also want to thank the citizens for coming out. I want to thank Nydia for videoing it for the people that can't come out to see it. My name's Stan Rutledge. I've been married for 20 years. I have 3 children and 6 grandchildren. I've been a paramedic since 1983. Been a firefighter since 1976. I'm an arson investigator, a private investigator, and been a deputy coroner for 3.5 years. I graduated from coroner training in 2012. I went to St. Louis School of Medicine last year as a mental legal death investigator. I'm the associate pastor and one of the founding members of Chesapeake Worship Center. And I'm not a career politician. This is my first campaign in my life, not the third campaign in 4 years. I would like to be next coroner because of my investigative and medical experience. I want to continue to serve as a citizen of Forsyth County and be the voice of the deceased. I have the compassion, the knowledge, and the integrity to serve as a citizen of Forsyth County.
And I'm sorry, and I forgot to have opening statements, so I appreciate you taking the opportunity to do that. And Lauren, if you go ahead and do your opening statement, you have 2 minutes.
Thank you. I'm Lauren McDonald III, been a resident of Forsyth County for 19 years. Forsyth County is a wonderful county, just from the school systems to the quality of life, and I'm real excited the opportunity to raise a family here in Forsyth County. The main reason I'm running for the office is the experience. The experience that I served this county for 12 years from 2000 to 2012, 2001 to 2012. I think that's the most qualifying thing that one needs as far as when you run for the office of coroner is the experience. I was a firefighter here for 19 years. I retired in 2013 with 25 years of full service in the state of Georgia. I do own McDonald and Son Funeral Home, which is a very successful business here in the county. It not only is the success that I have in the business, it's what we do in the community through the business with not only charitable, but what we do for kids in the community. We do Reality Check, which is a court-ordered, mandated teen facilitation where they come and go through what reality is if you make bad choices. The main thing is I want to ask your vote. I appreciate everybody coming out here tonight for coroner's races. I think Mr. Rutledge has said before that, you know, it's kind of a down ballot race and, you know, not many people are interested in it, and it's great to see everyone come out and listen to what both candidates have to say. Thank you.
All right, thank you, Lauren. And we'll go back now to Stan for the first question that I asked before mistakenly. Why are you running for the office of coroner?
I'm running for the office of coroner. I've been a deputy coroner here for 3.5 years. I'm an associate pastor, and my heart leads me, and my experience, my education leads me to help the deceased, their families, and to determine the manner and cause of death. The coroner's office is not, okay, let's go out and load the body up and carry to the funeral home or carry wherever. There's investigative efforts that have to go in to determine the manner and cause of death, and that's where my heart is.
All right, and Lauren?
The great part of sitting in this seat, and of course, Mr. Rudge, we determined this, I got the mute all button right here, so that was something he told me. I had to stay away from the mute all that shuts everything down up here. So I guess the chairman this reset, so he can do a lot. But going back to what we were talking about is the qualifications. I spent 12 years as your coroner. I think that says a lot. Through those 12 years, there were a lot of deaths that I did investigate. I think that the main thing and that one can do is the facilitation of the office to make sure that the families are served, that they get their answers that they need. We work well with the Georgia Bureau of Investigations. We work well with the Sheriff's Department, with their CSI, with their investigators. And that was where I got a lot of encouragement to come back and seek this office again. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, gentlemen. And now I'm going to go back to you, Lauren, for the second question. And I've got some questions here in front of me, and I'm doing them out of the order that they were given to me. What, in your knowledge and or experience, qualifies you for the position of coroner? You may have said some of that in your opening statement, but if you could just expound a bit on what qualifies you over your opponent for being the coroner.
The only thing that I can use against Mr. Rutledge is years of experience. He's taken a lot of the same classes I have that's required by the state. He met all the requirements that the state has for both of us to be able to run for this office. This is America. Any of you can run for the office of coroner. It doesn't. You don't have to be an ex-fireman. You don't have to be a paramedic. You don't have to own a funeral home to run for coroner. You have to have the heart and you have the mindset to deal with this job. It's not easy. It's not easy to be on call 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365, or be responsible for the office during that time. It takes a lot. On the county, they call it a part-time job, but it's not part-time. It's a lot of hours that you have to put in to doing the job, to serving the families, to serve working with the sheriff's office, to follow up with the GBI, and you got to be able to just to be able to have that time to do it.
All right, and Stan, the question is, what is your particular knowledge or qualifications that qualify you especially for this position?
Okay, so like I said, I've been an investigator. I've been in the business since 1976 as a firefighter. But like Lauren said, you don't have to be a firefighter. But being a paramedic gives you the medical knowledge. And being an investigator gives you knowledge on both sides. Being a medical investigator, handling medical patients and being an investigator helps me on both sides. Like I said, I'm an arson investigator. I've been a paramedic. I'm a private investigator. I've been a deputy coroner for 3.5 years. And I'm highly respected by the crime scene unit and the CID that we work with. We work closely with them. And we do a great job. We work as a team. And that's what it takes to do it. But the biggest thing is the medical legal death investigators class. It was a super class taught in St. Louis with a lot of medical examiners and forensics. It's a great class.
All right, we're going to shift gears here just a little bit to a little bit more of the administrative, boring stuff, but something that's important in a position of chief executive of a department. If you could please share your knowledge, and Stan, we'll start with you on this one. Share your knowledge and concerns and or what you feel is correct in it and or wrong with it when it comes to the budget of the coroner's office.
That's a good question, especially when, you know, you hear all the debates going on and the commissioners meeting. They're always ready to cut a budget and need to cut a budget. I looked at a little research on the budgets. We, since Ms. Pace took office in 2013, her budget in 2013 was $148,600. Lauren's budget in 2012 was $170,200. And so I guarantee you I'd have to continue her budget as keeping it as low as possible. She has bought a car and a cooler. That's why her budget's at 153. But her lowest budget 2013 was 148.6. So I would continue to work on that. It's a full-time job. You have to be in the office. You have to make sure the death reports are in and out and the death certificates are done.
All right, and Lauren, your feelings toward the budget and appropriateness of the current budget and or other needs.
And on reference back to the last year of office, where he was referring to the 174, if someone knew how to, if you could read a budget the way it was written, back then we were having fees that were impacted, placed on us by the county. which is $34,000 during that year, that they've decided to stop doing that. There were the internal service fees that they added to the coroner's budget. The actual budget was $147,000. The budget has gone up maybe $3,000 or $4,000 over the past couple years, which is now $161,200. So the budget has increased, but so is probably the call volume, the need. So the budget has not been abnormally increased over the years. I think it's been well managed by the current coroner, but I want to reference that 174, Mr. Rutledge, but that the 34,000 of that was internal service fees placed on us by items that we didn't even use in the coroner's office. Could you do better? You know, I think the budget is fine. I think Ms. Pace has a good sound budget. She's had to make some expenditures, but you have to do that after myself serving as 12 years as coroner. There are things she sees that she did not want to use, or vice versa. And so she's made some expenditures. So I don't think I think the budget is fine, BJ.
All right. Thank you very much. And we'll shift gears a little bit more again, and I'm going to combine two questions I have here in the interest of time and everything. I have, we're going to start with you on this one, Lauren. What is your assessment of the current relationships, and how important and what kind of emphasis do you believe needs to be put on maintaining a relationship with the Forsyth County Sheriff's Office and the local hospitals? So just kind of a general assessment of current relationships, and what do you think could be done better, and or how important are those relationships?
You know, the relationship is very important, I think, you know, because you're going into the different areas when you go out on a scene, out in the different environments that you're placed in. You have to be able to work with those deputies. You have to be able to work not only with the detectives, there's also a group within them, it's the CSI, it's the team that does the crime scene investigation by taking the samples, and you have to be able to make sure that you're not stepping on important things. You gotta know what you're doing. In the hospital, I think that's a relationship that's also important, because you're dealing with nurses, doctors, and they not only they've taken care of the business with the deceased, there are also a lot of patients that they're trying to save in there. So you know, you have to go in and make sure that you're not taking up too much of their time, that you can be able to wait to make sure that when they have the time to spend with you to go over each case. And I think that's a big thing is be able to manage that within the hospital.
Okay, and Stan, same question.
Okay, well, with the detectives and the uniform patrol and crime scene, we all work together on the same as a team. Like I said, you know, we'll get on the scene, we'll make pronouncements, and we won't enter until the detective gets there, and we'll go in with him, and crime scene goes in and takes care of all the photos and everything. So the working relationship with the street patrol, with CID, with crime scene is all. I mean, it's been a great relationship between us and CSI. The hospital, we had a great relationship over there. I mean, whether it's on the floor pronouncing somebody or in the ER. I mean, we'll go in, we'll photograph, we'll pull the chart and go through the chart, and the nurses and all are continuing to do whatever they do. And we'll get with the family, we'll meet with the family in a quiet room and ask the questions and do our investigation there. And at that time, we'll give a list of funeral homes if they don't know anything, and we'll assist the hospital in notifying the funeral home if the body's to be released to the funeral home. And we'll handle calling the GBI, the Georgia Bureau of Investigation, down there if we need to talk to the investigator, the medical examiner's office. But we work in the room where the deceased is, and we deal with the descendant's family and the nurse.
Okay, thank you. Let's see. continuing on with kind of a discussion on what's important in that, you know, the coroner's office could be a very isolated office because I don't think you want to have a lot of people just coming and visiting. Well, not live people. And not people voluntarily. But you have some opportunity for community outreach. So a question I've got here is, what can the coroner do to educate and reach out to the youth on the deadly consequences of texting while driving, driving under the influence, alcohol, consuming drugs, all those kinds of things? And Stan, we'll start with you, sir.
Okay, I know now that Ms. Pace goes out to the schools and goes out to different organizations and makes speeches on texting. Drugs is a big problem in this county among the teens. And I know she goes out, and I'll continue to do that outreach program like she's got it set up to go out and talk to the kids, talk to the teachers, to continue our outreach on it. But I know she does it now.
And I'll extend this just a second because you have a little bit more time, and then we'll do the same thing with Lauren. Is are there other you know, continuing a current program is interesting, but are there other, have you had any other ideas for what you could do?
Well, I mean, you know, like in the ambulance service, they had an Explorer program, but that's hard to do in a coroner's office because she ain't gonna take some kids out looking at a dead body. So I mean, I would look into extending the program. Maybe set up some kind of outreach, like at the fairgrounds or something during the fair, or to show the what our rates are and what the death ratio on the young kids, texting versus drug. And I know we assist every year with the schools.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, I heard an astounding statistic that you're 23 times more likely to get in a car accident than if you're not texting, and that's 2,300%. That's not 23% higher. It's 23 times, which is 2,300%. So, a very major thing we've got to deal with right now. Same question to you. What's your feeling on reaching out to the young and or any other ideas you might have, Lauren?
I think it starts with our youth. I mean, you can see even in other races, people are talking about it now. We have drug summits within the county trying to impact what's going on. We see that their challenge is out there. Back in my 12 years of being coroner in Forsyth County, I spoke continuously in the schools with our five high schools that we have. There's always an interest of what the reality could be if you did this. And a lot of times they would come to the coroner's office or even my personal business for us to come out and address these type issues. One of the things that Judge Jackson came to us and asked us to do was for the juvenile courts. And we've been doing it for over 4.5 years. When they have a little bump in the road and they have to go before Judge Jackson, he orders them to come to our personal business. And we started this through the coroner's office, but he wanted us to maintain it because it was making an impact. It not only made an impact for the kids, it was making an impact on the parents, because it's up to us as parents to control what's going on in our kids' life, because they're learning. They're learning every day on growing up. And so the court ordered the kid to come. We added that the parent had to come because we had to make these parents have some responsibility. I want to kind of back up to something that I was on the first board was our leader program. Our Rotary Club, Lanier Forsyth Rotary Club, bought the first simulator in our school system to try to get kids to learn how to the driving experience, because the schools were not providing driving school anymore. And so somebody had to make a difference. And Dr. Hogan had a vision. And he came to a few of us, and we began the process of the leader program. And I know there's probably 50 to 60 simulators now that the Forsyth County students have access to. The TIPS program that the Sheriff's Department is putting on, we're part of that now, that they come through our funeral home and have that same experience that they're having with the court order through Judge Jackson. Thank you.
Thank you, Lauren. These guys are doing a great job of keeping inside the time frame, but it's also pretty much ahead of schedule, so I may have to start making questions up. What's your favorite color or something like that? Let's see. Next question I've got, and then we're going to get into some questions that I'm, I think are more specific to the county and current situations and such, but they were given to me to be asked by the committee that put this together. But my next question is what is your experience, and Lauren, we'll start with you, sir. What is your experience in dealing with families who have lost a loved one? I guess with a funeral home, you have quite a bit of experience, but just describe your experience and approach.
Well, you know, the funeral home, the personal side of that is, and I've been doing that for about 24 to 25 years. When they get to the funeral home, everything is calm. Being a coroner is tough. Walking up in a hospital, and a lot of times the family doesn't know when you get there. They're still sequestered in a room. Somebody may not have told them, maybe they want to talk to the coroner before they go in and tell a family. Or when you have to go out to someone's home. It's a tough job, and nobody wants to see the patrol car, or especially the vehicle that says coroner on the side, pull up the side out. It has an effect on them. And doing it for 12 years, it had an effect on me. I mean, there was a needed break, and I enjoyed the 3 years. I did run for another office for unsuccessfully, but I don't regret that either. It was a great experience. But I take this opportunity for a job that I really loved. I loved being the coroner of Forsyth County and felt we did a great job. Being a coroner and owning a funeral, they're two different experiences that when you're dealing with a family, and they don't even compare to me from one to the other.
All right, thank you, sir. And Stan.
Okay. Yeah. Lauren's right. I mean, dealing with a family is a whole different situation than dealing with anything else out there. As an associate pastor, I have to deal with grieving families, and I've done it for a number of years. So dealing with families, for instance, I had one at the hospital the other night, and he was expected to pass, but not that soon. So I go in the quiet room with the family. And the lady, I mean, she was upset like you would expect. And she says, I say, can we get your pastor in here on staff to talk to you? She says, no, can you just pray with me? So it was a humbling experience to be able to come out and meet this family in her grieving time and give her a peace that she needed and also investigate her husband's death. But it is a humbling feeling to go out and to meet these grieving families. And I think Mary Beth's team does a great job on handling that and handling grieving families. It's a special thing. It's something you just can't read in a book and pick up.
Thank you, gentlemen. Both very compassionate answers, and I'm sure that's appreciated by everybody here. Next question that I've got is, we go back to administrative type thing, and the question as word is, if you're elected as a coroner, who will be on your team? But I don't know that we need names, but describe just how you believe the coroner's office needs to be organized and put together and how to utilize that.
Is that to me? Okay. I would keep the same team that I probably got now, because they're all medical or investigative backgrounds. They do a great job. I mean, I've had nobody say they were going to leave except for Mary Beth for emergency situations. So, and I've got a guy, that an investigator for a medical examiner that sent a resume, and I've also got an RN that has sent a resume. So they'll be medical or investigative type people.
And Lauren?
I think that was one of the most important things in deciding to run for coroner, besides enjoying serving this community, was the team that I put together. I reached out to someone that was my instructor 16 years ago that taught the coroner's curriculum that pretty much kind of developed where it is today. And he does cold case murders for Cobb County 2 days a week as contract labor. He's under contract with Gwinnett County doing some fire investigation. But he's a guy that's been an ex-GBI agent. He has taught forensics all over this state. Even when I was in Johns Creek, down with some policemen in Johns Creek today, everybody knew who he was. That's one that has really been excited about the opportunity to bring his knowledge of not only teaching coroners all over the state, but to actively be one here in this community. Of course, Hal Bennett, who sits in this room, wants to be on serve this community. He offered himself for coroner 3 years ago. He was a chief investigator for Cobb County. He is post-certified. He is an LPN. He was in the military. He's got tremendous amount of death investigation background that he wants to offer to this community. And then, of course, going digging back in the barrel is Nikki Stockel, who is she's a house coordinator at Northside Forsyth. Nikki is well respected in this community. She was coroner of the year for child fatality throughout the state, honored by the lieutenant governor of the state of Georgia. She served as my deputy coroner for 7 years. And just a wealth of knowledge. She's a forensic nurse. So that was important to me, to be able to do this job and to do it right, is to have the right team backing me to offer myself back to this community and offer this team to the community. I think that says a lot about the future of this coroner's office. Thank you.
All right, thank you, Lauren. We'll get into a little bit of the nuts and bolts also then here. What is your understanding of the need for a coroner's inquest, and when do you believe you would use such a tool or a process, and when wouldn't you?
A coroner's inquest is something when you have a death in a jail, and it's required that you do that. What you do, you would go to the clerk of court, to the superior court judge, and you would summon six people, and they would sit there as a jury, and they would hear the case and hear from both sides, and a lot of times in that is determining that you've gotten a cause and manner from the Georgia Bureau of Investigation. They just have to confirm that by the evidence that's presented to them. A family, they could push a coroner's inquest. And then, of course, they would produce their evidence of why they think something might have happened different than what you or the Georgia Bureau of Investigation has determined.
All right, Stan, you guys are catching on to how this works, right?
Yeah, I got it.
I know, I keep talking in between. Maybe I don't even have to do that.
I'm sitting over here.
Thanks.
But if a family requests a coroner's inquest, they have to request it within 30 days of the death certificate being signed. I don't know, unless Lauren's done a coroner's inquest, I don't know that there's ever been one in Forsyth County. But the next of kin could call for one, or if it's somebody dies in the jail, or I know they have them down at, like, I think it's Butts County all the time, down at Jackson. I know they have them there, but they're very few between.
Checks and balances of our system. I mean, it gives the citizens or a family an opportunity to question a decision. And I think that, you know, it's like in anything, if they didn't have that, you know, our society is just one-sided in it. So I think it's something that's given in Title 45 to the coroners to be able to go through that process and to help a family.
Okay, and then along the same lines, we'll go back to Stan for the first on this one. Along the same lines is, what is your, and now the question I have is, who has the final say in the cause of death? But I guess the question is, are you comfortable with the way that's being done now, or do you have concerns, how would you approach the final say in the cause of death?
No, I'm comfortable with the way it's been done. The medical examiner has the final say in the cause of death. Now, if you have a doctor that's been attending this patient, you know, he can say, okay, this is the cause of death, and he'll sign the death certificate. But it's between the coroner and the medical examiner, but the medical examiner has the final say.
Okay.
It's
With the medical exam, using the state medical exam, the Georgia Bureau of Investigation is kind of our big umbrella that we answer to, is when there is a death, we call them. If we don't have a doctor that's going to sign that death certificate, we take this case and we turn it over to the GBI. We call it in, and they have an investigator on that side that will then refer to one of the state medical examiner or part of his team with the case, and they determine whether they're going to ask for us to bring down that loved one to the GBI for an examination, or they may give us a sign off right there on the phone. The main thing, like in a hospital with only four death, is you have attending physicians. But a lot of times, that if there's an accident that might have preceded that death, weeks ago, the coroner has to co-sign that death certificate. So you have to work with that doctor to make sure that he even understands the proper places to sign his name, filling out the proper information, dates of injury, where there's surgeries involved. And all that's important, because if you don't do that, that death certificate is red flagged and it slows the whole process down for the family. So that's very important. And I never question, the doctors, when they sign it, they're the ones that have been treating the doctor, but a lot of times our signature just has to be on there for a cosign.
Can I interject? Did you?
Absolutely. Go ahead.
Okay. And Title 45 says if you go in the hospital and if you go in unconscious and you don't wake up within 24 hours, you die within the 24 hours, we have to go see them. And an accident, you have to go see them anyway, because it could be a coroner's case, and you'll call a GBI and they'll determine. But on an accident, and the 24 hours is out, you have to go see them.
Went backwards on my button. All right, thank you. And continuing with another technical question here. And the question is, in what circumstances is a coroner permitted to open a body bag that has been sealed as evidence by the sheriff's department? Who went? You guys went back and forth then. Now, see, I got lost. No, actually, you are first this time, Laura.
Me?
Okay. Yes, all right.
In no situation should you, once you're at the crime scene and you're leaving the scene, and you as a whether it's a detective, one of the CSI investigators, or the coroner, you've agreed that everything that you need on that scene is sealed in that body bag and put a tag on, that body should never be opened until it reaches the state medical examiner's office. No other circumstances should it be opened, because that is evidence that's supposed to be transported and trusted with the coroner to go from Forsyth County to the Georgia Bureau of Investigation, period.
Stan?
If you're working good with the crime scene tech, and if you're working with the detective on the scene, the coroner's ultimately responsible for the body. The sheriff's department is responsible for the crime scene. So when you call that GBI, you got to have everything that they're going to ask. You got to know what they want, even down to the color of the clothes. So it depends on the scene. I mean, I've never had one reopen, but I know there's times where they want to rush them off the scene, and they don't. And if you call a GBI, well, I need to know this. So there's times it would be open, but I mean, it's very rarely. Because usually when we put them in the transport to go to the GBI, unless there's no tables available, they go straight to the GBI sealed.
Well, going back to what he's saying, as far as, I still think that once that body leaves the scene and it's been sealed by the investigator, the crime scene tech, and the coroner, it should not be reopened. If the GBI has an extra question that you may not know the information on, you need to explain to the GBI the body is sealed. It's been done by this three groups of investigators, being coroner, sheriff's department investigator, and the CSI. It should not be touched. Say, hey, we're going to deliver the body down to you safely, and you hopefully get your answer from the investigator. If not, you can get it when you get there. But I don't ever think bodies should ever be reopened.
All right, thank you. Now, I've got some questions here that initiate rock throwing, and so that's where I'm a little bit not as. Here's what I want to. We're gonna go to questions. I'm gonna ask you a question that allows some rock throwing, and then we will go to a. Each one of you will be given the opportunity to ask the other one a question. But initially, I'm going to go ahead and say, if you were going to send out that piece of mail that everybody's going to receive at some point over the next couple of weeks, where you say horrible things about your opponent, Stan, what's that mail piece going to say about Lauren?
I don't believe I can say it in public. I hadn't really thought about it because me and Lauren are friends, and you know, and I don't like. I think people, Republicans, are tired of people going in the gutter. So I walk in the program, and I got to walk into Ingles, and I got to keep my head held high. And throwing Lauren in the gutter is not my game.
Okay, I'm going to guess what Lauren's going to say, but we'll go ahead and let him say it anyway. Go ahead, Lauren.
All right, y'all got all mine. No, listen, in a race like this, if you have an opportunity to get in front of somebody, if you could even afford to send the piece of mail out there in a race like this, it's got to be about you. It's got to be about what you want to provide the citizens of Forsyth County. It's got to be about fiscal responsibility with the money they entrust you with. This small budget for a coroner's office, I mean, you have to really watch that because they're not giving you any more. You got to manage it. And so that's the story you have to tell to the citizens. It's not about talking about the other candidate. My team that I've looked at putting together, that's my story. That's the story I want to tell the citizens about. What a gift to have the three people that want to be deputy coroners for y'all is what I want to tell 215,000 people in this community.
No private conversations up here to you two guys that seem to be really good friends. Okay, that was boring.
You got to wait 30 minutes.
Not how that was supposed to go at all.
So we're like that concert, we're like that show, you know, people still
the warm-up?
Concession stands and
the
popcorn and everything.
Well, I'll explain to the sheriff candidates that I already gave blood once today and I have no intention of doing it again. All right, here we're going to go with now, starting with Lauren, we'll have you go ahead and you have an opportunity to ask your opponent a question.
Hey Stan, what are some other visions on top of what you've talked about that you could see the coroner's office going to as far as the next level of serving this community?
I could see it going to the next level at, you know, Lauren, keeping the funeral home out of it and keeping just the coroner's office in the offices in and having my people trained in crime scene. Further training my people so they'll know what they're looking for when they go out to the next thing. And education's everything. With the coroner's office, it's with everything. So, I mean, I would have them trained more, but the most of all, I'd have them out in schools and in every chance they had to get to talk to the kids about drugs. Because drugs are killing our kids. Drugs and cell phones.
Now's your opportunity, Stan. Go.
Lauren, I think it was like 10 weeks ago, I called you out on a case in the hospital, you were standing in the hallway. It was me and you and the ER doctor standing there. And he goes, old coroner, new coroner. Remember our conversation? And Lauren said, I never want that office again. I've enjoyed watching my kids. I loved it when I did it, but I never want to run again. You'll never see my name, is what you told me and the doctor. So my question to you is, Lauren, what changed your mind?
I think the talking with the team that I put together was very encouraging to they, a lot of them came to me and wanted me to serve this community and this corner, and other people in the community had given me a call. I enjoyed being coroner. When the year that I decided to look at another office, there was a lot going on in my life, and I just decided that I needed a little break from the coroner's office. And of course, everybody has an opportunity to come back, change their mind, and do something they're passionate about. And I'm passionate about serving this community in the capacity as coroner. And I ask for each of your support.
Thank you, gentlemen. And we're gonna move into now closing comments. Who started? Stan started. Lauren, I'll have you go first this time on your closing remarks.
Well, again, I want to thank the Republican Party. I want to tell you why I'm Republican. I think that's important in letting you know what I stand for and the integrity that I have with my name. I wish my kids could come up here and talk to you about what it's like being a Republican. They get home from lacrosse at night, and first thing they do is to go to 360 on direct to watch Fox News to see what's going on in our nation. And it's inspiring for me to see youth that entrenched in this presidential race. They're Trump supporters. Their grandfather has his motorhome wrapped with Trump. And so every night there, last night was, it was popcorn night at the house. And so I look at them and look at the future of our community and what's going on even, with the drugs. I mean, it was getting really bad over the last year when I was serving as coroner. And it seems to only gotten worse. We gotta make a difference. Whoever the coroner is gotta get involved with our sheriff's department, with our schools, and letting these kids know the reality of doing drugs and what it'll do to you, period. I mean, that parents don't get a second chance to wind the watch back and say, hey, I wish I could have stopped that kid from doing that. I've sat down and heard that part from families. But the initial time of walking in and telling them their son's not going home, their daughter's not coming home, and it's tough. And I think with my experience, the main thing I tell you is the team I've put together. They've done this. They're more trained than I could ever be. Having sitting in this room, Bruce Willis, that taught me 16 years ago. And of course, what Nikki does at the hospital for the community and the outreach she's done through child fatality. So again, thanks Republican Party. I appreciate y'all putting this on. BJ, for coming across county lines and moderating this event, and wish you the best of luck the rest of the night.
You make it sound like a crime for me to come over here. My parents actually live here, so I have a little bit of basis for being in your county. Please don't have me arrested for crossing county lines. Stan.
You need a passport.
What's that?
You didn't need a passport.
I need a passport. Stan, give us your last 2-minute elevator.
Okay. I want to thank everybody for coming out and listening to the coroner's race, because I think the coroner's race, nobody, like me and Lauren was saying earlier, nobody really cares about it unless you need it. And then we're the mouthpiece of the deceased. But I want to thank everybody coming out and listening to us. I think this is what, I give you my education. I've been a deputy coroner for 3.5 years, a mental legal death investigator, arson investigator, private investigator, and firefighter and paramedic. But my problem, and Lauren knows it, we talked about it many years ago, I think it's a conflict of interest for a funeral home to run a coroner's office. Because if my loved one was laying in the hospital and they give me a number to call, and I called that number, and it was a funeral home number, that ain't what I called. I'm looking for the coroner. So I think that's a big conflict of interest, and that's why I'm running, and I love Warren to death, but I think it's wrong.
Thank you, everybody, and we will take a short break to reset up for the next week.
I'm going to come up.